Morning. It's good to see you today. I trust you've had a wonderful week. Isn't this weather wonderful? And it'll probably snow tomorrow, but anyways, enjoy it today while you can, okay? If you're a guest today, thank you for coming to Calvary. It's always a delight to have folks come and worship with us for your first time, second time, third time, or whatever. You just make yourself at home, and if you're looking for a church home, if it's God, where God wants you to be, then you just do what you need to do about that. You can come by way of letter, statement, or baptism. But the important thing is you be doing what God wants you to do, where he wants you to do it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we are thankful for another day. Thank you for this privilege to be in your house today to worship you. Thank you for everyone who is here today. Thank you for our guests. I pray, Lord, for every need throughout the congregation. There are so many things, Lord. We couldn't begin to name them. But, Lord, you know everything about them, and I'm so thankful that because of who you are, we can very carefully and comfortably place this in your care and in your hands and trust you with it. Now, we pray your blessings on our services today, as you've already been with us in our Bible study time. Now, as we come to the point where we worship, I pray for our choir as they sing, that you'd bless them, Brother Bruce, as he leads. And when it comes time to proclaim the word of God through the preaching, I pray your anointing. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and amen.
Good morning, Calvary. Glad that you're here today. If you will, stand with me as we worship singing together this morning, Shout to the Lord. Sing with me, my Jesus.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love.
My shelter, tower.
Just a few weeks ago, we actually celebrated what we call Easter Sunday, the risen time that the Lord arose from the grave to justify and forgive us of all of our sins. If that resurrection hadn't have taken place, I can't imagine where we'd be today. Could you? Let's continue to worship this morning. It says, "See What a Morning," entitled Resurrection Hymn. See what a morning. Singing a song for you now, but we have sung this song many times. Many of you know it, so we invite you to sing along with us. It's entitled Honey in the Rock.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know.
for a miracle, thirsting for the living well. Only you can satisfy. Sweetness at the mercy seat, now I've tasted, it's not hard to see.
There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock. There's honey in the rock.
It's time now for our children to go to their place of worship. So fifth grading under, you make your way down. Miss Janice will meet you here.
Vacation Bible School training this afternoon. There's lunch provided for you. So if you're involved in that training, you make sure that you get over there as quickly as possible after the invitation. Don't leave during the invitation. But they're going to feed you, and you're going to have some good training and preparing for Vacation Bible School, which is just around the corner. Comes fast, doesn't it? Seemed like just yesterday, and now here again. Open your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 24 this morning for a reading. I love this passage of Scripture, just like I love all of them. I would tell you this is my favorite, but you'd say it can't be because you said that other one was your favorite. This is one of my favorites because it speaks to the kind of individuals that we are. And I think we'll find ourselves somewhere in this particular passage, somewhere in the thoughts that God has given me to share with you this morning. Luke chapter 24, stand with me. We'll begin reading verse 13. Of course, after the resurrection and all that has taken place. Behold, two of Jesus' disciples, them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs, which is about 7 miles. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they were communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. And their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as ye walk and are so sad? Father, add your blessings to your word now. If you don't preach, there'll be no preaching. If you don't anoint, there'll be nothing going into our hearts. Now, the word is satisfactory in that we can just read it and apply it to our lives. It's transforming. But Lord, you've called me to this sacred responsibility and privilege to proclaim the word of God to your people and to those, Lord, who need to hear what's said today. So whatever it may be that needs to happen in our lives, may we be responsive to your leadership in Jesus' name. And amen. Thank you. Please be seated. What a day it must have been. Now, we know on Friday what a bad day it was for all of God's believers, all of Jesus' followers, and for the pain and tragic discomfort and abuse that our Lord Jesus took on the cross, dying on the cross for our sins. And in keeping with the commandment of God, slain before the foundation of the world, Jesus was buried. And on the third day, he what? He rose again. And early in the morning, very early, before the sun even came up, some of the women, led by Mary Magdalene, had made preparation to go and anoint the body of Jesus, and they talked among themselves, and this is Easter stuff, talked among themselves, who's going to roll that stone away? And when they got there, and guess what? The stone had already been rolled away. And you know all the things that took place there and the excitement, the angels were there and the testimony of the angels. And then the ladies went into town and told the disciples, and Peter and John ran to see what this commotion was all about. And sure enough, there was an empty tomb and word spread. Jesus talked to Mary Magdalene. The Bible says he talked to some of the other ladies. I mean, it was all over the networks. It was on the internet that Jesus had risen from the dead. This particular passage of Scripture that we're looking at today seems to say to me, we've all been on this road, the road to Emmaus. What is that road to Emmaus? It's a road that takes us away from the Lord. Some folks sitting in this room right now, you know beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you're on the wrong road. You're on the wrong path. You've turned and walked away from maybe your duty, maybe your calling. Maybe it's something gone on in your life like was with these two men as they walked that journey of 7 miles home, away from all the wonder that had taken place on Easter Sunday. Talking among themselves and journeying among themselves. And you know, when two people walk together, you don't even know you've taken a walk. I ask my wife sometimes when she and Aunt Gail, her sister, walk back in the woods and the hills and vales and valleys and so forth, and across streams and rivers and all the different things they do. And I say, how was your walk? She said, I don't know. I said, why don't you know? She said, I don't remember it. So you get so caught up in walking. Now, the only comfort I can say that these two men had for one another, misery loves comfort. And they were two miserable people who, walking away from all that had happened on that day, that morning, and it seemed as they walked, they were so sad. We could say they were discouraged. We could say they were disappointed. We could say they were depressed. And so they fed off one another. Well, you know this, you know that, and then on it goes. I've thought of several titles for this message today. And the thought came to me from one of the songs that our choir sings from time to time. Boy, I love it. The goodness of God is running after me. I mean, you can't run away from God. Now, we'll talk about Jonah tonight. We won't talk about him right now, but you can't run away from the Lord. And here these two men, as they're making their journey, leaving all the beauty and wonder of what had happened and the story of the risen Savior, they're not going to go tell people that Jesus had risen. They're on the run because they don't believe that he has risen from the dead. Is that your case today? Is that why you're going the wrong direction? You have doubts about where Jesus has really risen from the dead or not? Well, according to many, many witnesses and according to many folks in this room today, he is risen because you ask me how I know he lives. He lives where? He lives within my heart. All these men on their journey. We often say, well, there are two roads. There's a road that's mostly traveled. There's a road less traveled. And we think, well, the hard road is the one that is less traveled. The one we're talking about today is the one that's most traveled by all the people who claim to know Jesus as their Savior. They're just going the wrong way. Why are they going the wrong way? What has happened to them? We've already mentioned a few of those things. We've talked about the fact that happened just like you, happens to me sometimes. We get discouraged. We get disappointed in the way things are going. We have it written down, God, this is the way it's supposed to go. Step 1, 2, 3, 4. And if it don't go that way, Lord, I'm going the other way. It may be that you're just depressed about other things in your life. It could be sicknesses come into your life. And you thought, well, because I'm a child of God, he takes care of everything that goes on with me, so I don't need to be concerned about sickness. But sickness comes and it lingers. Heartache comes and it lingers. People walk away from you and the pain lingers. We struggle. And so consequently, it will cause us to do an about face and walk away from all the things that's important. I love this story because Jesus, who has risen from the dead, wants to see his people rise to the occasion, be what they're supposed to be. But instead of these two men who were disciples, how close they were, we do not know that. We did not know both of their names. One of them, Cleopas, and what was the other one's name? I think the reason his name is left out, because it's your name. Cleopas and you talking among yourselves. I'm so upset. I'm so mad. I'm so disappointed. I've not been done right. God didn't do me right. All my hope is gone today, and so I'm just throwing up my hands, and I quit. But tell you something about the Lord. He won't let you get away with that. And the case that we have here before us, as these men journey on their journey of sadness and just jab, 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 back and forth with one another, Jesus comes and begins to walk beside of them. Can you imagine the comfort of the presence of Jesus Christ in their life right then? They didn't know who he was. He was disguised to the point that they did not need to know who he was. But as he journeyed with them and began to talk with them, here's the thing that I want us to think about this morning is that as you make your journey of life, and the Lord, you know the Lord never leaves you nor forsakes you, so he is with you in your journey. Talk to him. Talk to him. He just point blank says, why are you so sad? He opens the door for them to say what's on your heart. And I challenge you with this today. When things aren't going right with you, you don't get mummed up and shut up and go hide in a corner. You talk to the Lord. He says, why are you so sad? Spill the beans. And of course, they say, what are you new? Don't you know what's gone on in Jerusalem? Don't you know this one that we look for, this Messiah that was to come, came, and we look forward to him setting up a kingdom and all the wonderful things that promised us that are going to come true? And they took him and they crucified him. I'm just over it. I don't like the turn this has taken. I'm disappointed in what God has done, what Jesus has promised, and he didn't deliver. Oh, my. He even told them, says, you foolish people. You missed it all. So whatever's going on with you today, you can talk to somebody. And it's good to have people that you can talk to that'll help you. You don't want miserable comforters. You don't want folks to agree with everything you're saying. You want somebody to tell you what? Tell you the truth. And so it's good to have someone to talk to. And I tell folks this often. Be careful who you talk to. Could I go just a little bit? Be careful about who you tell your deepest secrets to. You can't, you say, preacher, I can tell them anything. How come everybody knows it next week? Quit meddling and started preaching, didn't it? Or quit preaching and started meddling. I don't know what it. But be careful who you tell your innermost secrets to. I don't care if they're a confidant. You have to be careful. Best person to talk to is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he says, talk to me. Tell me what's going on with you. And then not only the comfort of his presence and the privilege they had to be able to talk to him, but the comfort of his word. He said, let me talk to you. And so basically he opened up the word of God to them. And began to explain to them, says, do you not remember? And boy, he took them all the way back and jotted every crossed every T and dotted every I and explained all the things to them about the Lord Jesus Christ and the prophecies of him coming and the prophecies of what was going to happen to him, the prophecies of him being buried and rising from the dead, all those things as he began to talk to them. I mean, I'm sure they were encouraged a bit as they walked along the way. Take counsel in the Lord. Tell your heart to the Lord. Number two, take the word of God and hear what the word of God has to say. Just because you don't understand something doesn't mean it's not true. But folks, I'm going to tell you, this book holds the inerrant, infallible word of God. Now, I'm telling you, you said, well, if I read another book, it said thus and so. Throw that book away. Get rid of it. If it conflicts with the truth of God's word, get rid of it. There's a lot of naysayers out there. There's a lot of non-believers out there. There's a lot of people, they have studied this and they've studied that, and they go back many years perhaps about what somebody else said. Let's stick with what God said. The presence of his word, the wonder of his word. And the presence of him walking with them. He walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I'm his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever known. I think this trip of 7 miles was probably the quickest 7 miles these guys had ever known. Because while they journey on their way there, to Emmaus, going home. I think that's where they were going. All of a sudden, their house, their home. And the Bible says that Jesus made it if he was going to go on his way. And the Bible says they begged him to stay. Now, I think there's two reasons why he asked them, or they asked him to stay. Number one, it was a hospitable thing to do, and to invite him in because he was a stranger to them, and he to them, and vice versa. And so they invited him to come and to stay at their house. It's evening time. It's getting dark. And so stay with not only hospitality, but I think that there was something about his presence that wanted them to stay with him. A hunger of your heart. Nothing sweeter than the presence of the Lord in your life. There's nothing sweeter than knowing that you know that you know that you know. The Bible says Jesus made it as if he would go on home, go on down the road. But he came on in with them. Kind of reminded me of the passage in Revelation chapter 3, verse 21 or 2. I'm not sure exactly. The Bible says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. He that openeth the door, I will come in and sup with him. I will be his father, and he will be my son. We'll be friends." But he said, "I knock at your door." And maybe today, right now, in your despondency and your discouragement, as you've walked on the way and you've walked away from God, you've walked away from your duty, and you're headed to another place where you don't need to be. And he walks with you and he talks with you and he calls you out, so to speak, and says to you, "This is what you need to do." There was a hunger in their hearts to hear more from him. And so they invited him in. Did you know you can't just say, "I'm going to get saved," and get saved? You know, I've got it on the calendar on the 29th of April, I'm going to walk the aisle for Jesus. If that's not on God's calendar, you can forget it. I remember several years ago, I had a man. Talked to him about salvation, and he said, "I'm going to get saved. I need to get saved." He said, "But I'm going to walk out one day." He said, "But I want to come, but there's a lot of people there." You know what he was about? Show. So God calls us to salvation through his word, through his spirit. "And behold, I stand at the door and knock. And him, I will hear my voice. Hear my voice. And invite me in, so to speak, then I will come in and sup with him and he with me." It gets richer. I tell you, the longer you walk with the Lord, the more you know about him, the sweeter it gets, doesn't it? They sit at the table, and I think the Lord continues to speak to them. I think they continue to have conversation. I don't know what all the conversation was about. Maybe it had to do with the things we've already mentioned here, but they continue to talk. And so were they invited him, or he took the position? I'm sitting at the head of the table. And the Bible says that he broke the bread and he what? He blessed it. And it was there, the Bible says, that I don't know, I cannot prove this, I've often said this, that when he broke the bread and blessed it and maybe lifted his hands and blessing it by praying, what did they see perhaps? Scars in his hands? I don't know, but I like it. Whatever they saw, whatever they sensed, they knew it was Jesus. And all of a sudden, all this blurriness cleared up, and they realized it was the Lord Jesus Christ who had walked with them, who had talked with them, who had comforted them, had encouraged them, and told them the truth, and that they need to believe the truth. And boy, were they tore out of their frame. "Yeah, I guess we just go to bed now because he's gone. He's just gone." The Bible says they continue to have a conversation. I don't know whether Cleopas looked over at me or Cleopas looked over at you and said, "Didn't our hearts burn within us as we walked by the way. I call that holy heartburn. Now, last week I had a bad case of heartburn. I'm telling you what, for 3 days I hurt. I took every pill I had. Didn't help. But this is a holy heartburn. Our hearts stirred. And have you ever taken the Word of God and began to read a passage that it was your day to be enjoined to that Word, and God speak to you through that Word, through the Holy Spirit, and it just lit your fire? Do you know what I'm talking about? So didn't our hearts, when we just set on fire? And they said, I think we need to go back to Jerusalem. I think we need to turn around. And I don't know how quick it took them, but in the night, in the darkness of the night, the Bible says those men, those two men, headed back to Jerusalem. And as soon as they got there, they began to say, we have seen him. He's alive. He's alive. He came to us. He walked with us. And they told the experience that they had. They said, yeah, we know it. He's already spoke to Peter. We have seen him. And yes, he is alive. Boy, they had a hallelujah spell just meeting and talking. And all of a sudden, guess who appeared into their presence? There he was. Jesus. Now they had a little bit of comments. They had peace be unto you. I can't think of a better time to have peace in your life is when the Lord just comes into your presence and makes himself known. And here's the interesting thing. He said, you boys got anything to eat? That sounds like me, actually. Got anything to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish. Maybe Long John Silver's fried fish. I don't know. I believe he ate that fish and licked his fingers. I don't think they've said a word. I think they're in awe at the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what does that mean? In his glorified body, he was eating. Do you reckon in your glorified body you'll be able to eat? Here's what I say about that. If you're supposed to eat in heaven, you'll what? You'll eat. If he wants banana pudding in heaven, what? There'll be banana pudding in heaven. Here's the thing. Whatever it's going to take in heaven to bring you happiness and joy, it's going to be there. But I think everything you're going to need is going to be present with the Lord, and you're going to experience ecstatic life like you've never known it. They shared that. And they rejoiced in the fact that the Lord had risen. Isn't it great that the Lord took time out of all he had to do to follow after those two guys? Just demonstrating the goodness of the Lord that follows after us. That comes after us in our weakness, in our sorrow, in our discouragement, in our depression. He comes after us. There's only one answer for that. The Lord loves us. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you've come from. I don't care what you have done, what your past is like. He loves you. There's not a thing in the world you can do to make him stop loving you. Do you hear that? There's another thing you can do to make him love you more. He loves us. Let me take you on a quick journey now. We're circling. We'll land. The goodness of the Lord came running after Adam and Eve. After they sinned that horrible sin. Folks, let me tell you, when you doubt the Word of God, you're in trouble. You're on your way to a fall if you're not careful. And that's what happened to them. But the Lord loved Adam and Eve so much that he came after them. And he delivered them from what would have been a horrible end. He came after Elijah. Oh, Elijah had done so many wonderful things. He had worked miracles. He had preached the Word of God. He had preached there on Mount Carmel and all that business with the prophets of Baal and so forth. And then all of a sudden, fear came into his life. Doubt came in his life. Discouragement, depression set. And he ran from God. He said, I'm done with it. I'd rather be dead. But guess who came running after him? And there in that cave, he said, E.J., what are you doing here? He said, I'm done with it. I'm mad. You're not treating me right. You let that old little-lipped woman threaten to kill me, and I ain't putting up with it. He said, you need to get up and get out of here and get back where you're supposed to be. He did some wonderful things. Now, read that story about 1 Kings chapter 17, 18, 19. Boy, what a beautiful story that is. He came after Zacchaeus. We talked about him a week or so ago. But he, because of his love for Zacchaeus, he came after Zacchaeus. He just stopped under that tree, and Zacchaeus, what? Come down out of that tree. I'm going to go to your house today. His goodness came running after that woman at the well. What a mess her life was. Too much to even try to explain or discuss. But the bottom line to her life, she was miserable. But the Lord Jesus must needs go through Samaria. Why did he do that? Because he loved her. Why did he come after you? In your sin, in your wickedness, in your vile way of living, running and doing what you felt like you wanted to do, but yet his great love for you came and knocked on your heart's door and invited you to receive him as a Savior. And you do it because of his love. He just don't let up. He just keeps coming after you. Came after me. I was a good guy. I was Mr. Christian. You name it, I did it. Isn't that Steve such a wonderful Christian? I just wish everybody could be like him. I was as miserable as I could be. And for one reason, the Holy Spirit had convicted me. I was lost. And there's only one way that that could be turned around, and I would admit I was a sinner and ask him to come to my heart and be my Savior. And it's the goodness of God that just kept running after me, bringing me to where I needed to admit that I was a sinner. Do you remember your time? Do you remember when you were on the run? You were in rebellion? Well, you were disappointed. You experienced some defeat in your life and said, well, God, you can do better than that, and I'm over you. He just stays after you. Several years ago, I taught a young lady in school, and as I've talked with her about the need to live right, she said, I know I need to change my ways. She said, but here's the way it is. I'm a preacher's daughter. By the way, not every preacher's son or every preacher's daughter does right. Got it? Preacher, what are you saying about Paul and Kara? I'm not saying nothing about them. I'm just saying we're all sinners saved by what? By grace. But she said, I've done some dumb things. She said, on Saturday night when we'd all get ready and go to bed at home, what I'd do is I'd change my clothes and I'd put on my red dress. I'm just using the red dress as a symbol because I love red. And she said, I'd slip out the window and I'd go with my friends. And I won't tell you about some of the things we've done. Years passed, she graduated and encountered her once again. She was living someplace near me. I won't go into detail about that, but she was living in a trailer beside of another trailer. And I found out she lived there, so on one occasion, Faye and I went to visit. This is where Faye learned to handle snakes. But what had happened in her life is that She lived in this trailer with her husband and her little boy, and another family lived here, man and his wife lived in this trailer, and they decided they'd change trailers. They didn't change trailers, they just changed who lived where. She moved in with this guy, and this girl moved in with this guy. She said, "Preacher, does that stuff go on?" Just look around the world today. But in the process of time, these two men plotted a scheme to rob a store. So they robbed a store, got caught, and they went to jail over it. I don't know all the details of that thing, but in the process of all this sadness and grief in her life, Faye and I went to visit her. And Faye sat outside the door with the little boy, because little boys and little girls can interfere with witnessing pretty easy. I remember Brother Roy Gilbert, several years ago, we used to visit together. And I said, he was quiet. He was a quiet man. He didn't say nothing. One thing Brother Roy could do, he could run a vacuum cleaner. And he could take kids into the kitchen and play with them while I share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The reason you go in pairs is because you have witness. Now, sometimes you need somebody to look after the kid, and somebody need to run a vacuum cleaner. But we went to visit, and she sat outside the trailer with a little boy. That's when snake wrapped around her legs there. Devil's everywhere. You know that, don't you? But went in and was talking with her, and godly sorrow just come on her. Godly sorrow is what leads a person to repentance. Godly sorrow is not when you get caught and you wish you hadn't got caught. Godly sorrow is when you know that you have sinned against God and in your heart you have grief over it. But as I talked with her and told her the need to be saved, I made a comment to her. I said, "Do you love that little boy sitting out there with that Sister Faye is holding and talking to?" She said, "I love him with all my heart." I said, "You know, I know a greater love than that." She said, "What love's that?" That's the love that God has for you. Even in spite of what you have done, in spite of your heartache, and in spite of the sin that you've been been living in spite of what's happened in between these two trailers and such, God loves you. And he loves you so much that he wants to save you. He pursues you. And she broke down and began to weep. And here's the words that came out of her mouth before she said, "Jesus, come into my heart, be my Savior. Lord, I'm thankful you didn't give up on me. I'm thankful that you didn't stop chasing me." And she didn't say these words, "And I'm thankful your goodness kept coming after me." And folks, that's the way God operates. Now, in order to be saved, you have to be convicted by the power of the Holy Spirit. God calls our hearts to salvation, but you've got to be willing. Not everybody's going to heaven. Do you know that, don't you? But only those who have called on the Lord Jesus Christ and said, "Come to my heart, be my Savior." And with that being said, while these two disciples, I believe, knew God, knew the Lord, he had to come after them to turn their life around. And so he comes into this room today, up and down these pews, walks into the pews and says, "It's time you turned around. It's time you forsook going the wrong way. It's time you realize that the Lord loves you and that I'm here for you and I'll help you." And in your discouragement, in your despair, in your depression, in this rebellion that you have because you don't want to do the will of God, he loves you enough to stay after you to where you'll surrender. And that's about the deepest love you're ever going to find. He does not give up. Would you bow your heads, please? Just a moment, we're going to sing a song of invitation. He's walked into this building today and through the Word of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, and he's knocked on your heart's door. It may be the need to come to Jesus for salvation. and you have rebelled. You have pushed him away. You have denied him. But he still keeps coming after you. And the reason he does that is because he loves you. Under the convicting power of the Holy Spirit, just simply say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. Come to my heart and be my Savior. He will save you. It's not the words that does it. It's that faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So if that's what your need is today, he's come today to call you out. And his love keeps running after you. That's why you're under convicting power today. It might be something that's going on in your life you know is contrary to the will of God. And then just bottom down, if it's contrary to the will of God, it's called sin. And he's called you out. And he's chased you and he's come after you with his love and his goodness and said, repent. Maybe that's what you need to do today. Maybe you're just discouraged. And yet he's come to you today and says, be not discouraged. I'm here for you. I'll encourage you. I'll walk with you. And he gives you all the reasons why you need to turn to him and love him and trust him. What is it God said to you today? The road to Emmaus, the road that's most traveled, people running after, running away from the plan of God, running away from salvation, running away from the resurrection, running away from the duty God's given you to do. All you got to do is say, Lord, I surrender. Father, have your way in every heart and every life. Somebody just needs to get out of their seat and come to an old-fashioned altar and say, Lord, I'm sorry. May they be willing to do that and say, Lord, I repent. I'm turning back around. I'm going back in the right direction. Thank you for convicting power of the Holy Spirit on my life. And Lord, thank you for not giving up on me. And I ask you to come in my heart and be my Savior. Thank you, Lord, you've never stopped chasing me. You never stopped loving me. And because of that, I surrender today. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, we're the clay. Mold us and make us after thy will while we're waiting, yielded and still. In Jesus' name, amen. While we stand and sing,
have thine own way, Lord.
Altar's open. You just need to come and pray. You come on and do that.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me.
Another verse, come on.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. In thy presence, humbly I bow.
Some time ago, I was in a conversation with a man about who needed to give his heart to Christ, and he'd been in rebellion against it, and we had talked on different occasions. On one particular time, we were talking, and he just got frank with me. Here's his words. I'm not about to walk down that aisle and become a second-class citizen. Why? Folks, when you join with Jesus, you become first class all the way. And it doesn't get any better than Jesus Christ. It wasn't long after that till he wept himself to an old-fashioned altar and he realized it wasn't second class at all. It was first class. And folks, that's why Jesus pursues us. He wants us to have the best that he can give. And he left it all to come down here so we could have all he's got. Why reject such great blessings of the Lord? God said, make Calvary your home. You come by way of a letter, by state, by baptism. If you've not been saved, you need Jesus today. Today is the day of salvation. How do you know? Because the Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart through the Word of God. And today is the day. While we sing another verse.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way.
Aren't you glad the Lord loves you? Amen. Aren't you glad you have the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord today? Yes. Now tonight we're going to have a good discussion about attitude adjustment. And we're going to spend some time tonight talking about a man by the name of Jonah who needed an attitude adjustment. I'll be talking to you and me tonight because every now and then we need what? An attitude adjustment. So make plans to come back tonight. We're going to have a great time. I'm going to be here. Faye said she's going to come with me. Brother Bruce, he'll be here because he has to be here to sing. But what a privilege. What a privilege we have just to be together. Don't forget VBS training, food involved, and enjoy the training and get ready for Vacation Bible School. Our Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you that you didn't give up on us. Thank you that you loved those two men on the road to Emmaus as you went lit out after them. And you wanted them to turn their life back around and serve a risen Savior. Thank you for what you've done in our lives, Lord, to make that real to us. Bless us now as we go from this place. Bring us back safely tonight in Jesus' name. And amen. God bless you. Liberty, go.